differential equation, first we will understand the definition of linear differential equation. So what kind of ODE, what kind of ordinary differential equation is actually categorized as linear differential equation? So let's look into the definition first. So linear differential equations are those in which the dependent variable, you can call it as y. Let's say if you are having dy by dx or d2y by dx square, such kind of differential coefficients present in the ODE, then y can be called as a dependent variable. And its derivative occurs only in the first degree. Now, what is the meaning of occurs only in the first degree? That means no differential coefficient should have a power more than 1 on it. Okay, exactly power 1 should be there, whether it is dy by dx, whether it is d2y by dx square. In fact, the dependent variable also should occur in the first degree. That means there should be no y square, y cube kind of a term. Okay. And one more thing. And they should not be multiplied together. Okay. So a general linear differential equation would actually look like this. Let's say I go to a nth order linear differential equation. So it will look like this. Plus some P1 dn minus 1y by dxn minus 1 plus P2 okay, dot 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 till let's say PNY equal to some X. Okay, now here please note the coefficients that you see here, P1, P2, etc., they are all either functions of X or constants, including your X1. So P1, P2, P3, etc., till PN, including your x, are either constants or functions of x. Remember, constants can be also termed as functions of x. In fact, constants can be functions of any variable you want. But in this lecture, my dear students, I am going to only talk about linear differential equations with constant coefficients here. So I'll be talking about only those situations in this video. I'll be only talking about where your P1, P2, etc. are constants. So I'm going to talk about linear differential equation with constant coefficients. Okay. I'll be not going into any other higher version of linear differential equation. Why I am mainly interested in LDE with constant coefficient is because you will find that these equations are very much used in the study of electromechanical vibrations and other engineering concepts. Okay, I am sure you would have all done concepts related to simple harmonic motion, right? Motion of simple pendulum, or you would have done oscillation of springs, or you would have done oscillatory electrical circuits. Like LC circuit, LCR circuit, right? LC circuit with EMF, LCR circuit with EMF. In engineering, we study the deflection of beams, whirling of shafts, right? Lot of application is there for linear differential equation, my dear, in the field of physics and engineering. So I'll be only talking about those cases where you have these P1, P2 till Pn, etc. as constants, and of course x could be some function of x. See, a linear differential equation solution is called a complete solution, okay, which we write it as CS, Okay. Complete solution is made up of two things. One is called the complementary function. Okay. And the other is called the particular integral. Other is called as the particular integral. So I will tell you how to find both of these components, whether complementary function or particular integral for different cases. Okay. And those will be the only cases that will be coming for your problem solving in physics or any engineering exam. So CS, what we call it, is made up of CF and PI. Okay. So complete solution is made up of CF plus PI. So first I will talk about how to find CF. How to find CF, complementary function. Before you understand complementary function, you have to understand a very small thing which is called the operator D. Okay. So operator D. What is operator D? Normally, what do? Is we use some operator to define such operations in calculus. For example, d by dx is written like operator D. D2 by dx square, this is called d square. Okay. D3 dx cube, this is called d cube. Okay. And so on. I hope you would have got the pattern. So if you have the nth derivative happening with respect to x, or respect to the independent variable, we call it as dn. For example, d2y by dx square plus 2dy by dx minus 3y. This you would write as d2 plus 2d minus 3y. Okay. Now I will tell you why we use this operator d. In order to find complementary function, we frame something which we call as the auxiliary equation, also written as AE. Okay, let me give you an example. For example, the previous question. Let's say I want to find out the complementary function for this differential equation. Okay. So what do we do first? We write this like d2 plus 2d minus 3y, okay, equal to 0. Now this equation that you have over here, this equation, when you create like this, this is called the auxiliary equation, AE. Complementary function depends upon the roots of the auxiliary equation. How it depends? Let us look into this example. So if there is an auxiliary equation like this, we factorize it. So let's say the factorization of this will be d plus 3d minus 1. Okay. From here we get two roots for d. Okay, what are the roots here that we get for d? The roots that we get for d are minus 3 and 1. Correct? Now, I will not go into the details of how do we get this, but the complementary function that we will get will be nothing but c1 e to the power minus 3x plus c2 e to the power 1x, where c1 and c2, are arbitrary constants. Okay. Now, how to find these arbitrary constants? You would be given some initial conditions or boundary conditions into the question, through the use of which you can find this C1 and C2. Remember, don't forget your basics. Any nth order differential equation will always have n arbitrary constants into it. Okay. Now, this is a very simple example, but let me give you a generic view of this. Let us say you have got a differential equation which looks like this. Okay, I'm just taking a nth order linear differential equation for you. Okay, let's say this goes till k n y equal to 0. Okay, so to find complementary solution, what would you do? You will find the auxiliary equation. Auxiliary equation would be dn k1 d to the power n minus 1 k2 d to the power n minus 2 up till kn. Okay, put it to 0. Now, it is not because there was a 0 over here. Let's say even if there was any function of x, you would do the same thing to get the auxiliary equation. Okay, so don't get me wrong here. You have not put it 0 because there was a 0 here. I have changed it to x. X could be some function of x. Okay, so now let us say the following cases will arise. Let us say this n degree equation in the operator D is factorizable. Okay, and I get these n factors from there. Okay, so when n distinct factors are coming here, so let's say it's a case where the roots where m1, m2, etc., all these values are real and distinct. Okay, then in such case, your complementary function is given by c1 e to the power m1x, c2 e to the power m2x, and so on till cn e to the power mnx, where again c1, c2 till cn, etc. are arbitrary constants. Okay, so nth order differential equation will have n arbitrary constants. Okay, don't forget that. Okay, case number two. In case number two, what if any two of the roots become equal? So let us say out of those m1, m2, m3 till mn roots, two of them are equal. Okay, let's say m1 and m2 are equal and the other are distinct. Okay, so let's say the others are distinct. Okay. In such case, again, I will not go into the derivation part because I know you are here to get the idea how to solve a linear differential equation with constant coefficient. You don't want to get into too much of theory, else this video will become too long. In such case, your solution will become, your complementary function will become c1x plus c2. And the roots which were repeated, let's say I write m1 and m2 are same, so you can write c to the power m1x, and the others will be the same as it was before. That is c3 e to the power m3x, c4 e to the power m4x, and so on till cn e to the power mnx. Now a natural question will arise in your mind, what if three of them were repeated, right? So here I took an example of two being repeated. Let's say if three of them were equal, if m1 is equal to m2 is equal to m3 and others were all distinct, let's say m4, m5, etc. till mn, then your complementary function would become c1x square, c2x, c3, e to the power, any one of the name you can take, m1x let's say. And others would remain the same. Let's say c4 e to the power m4x, c5 e to the power m5x, and so on till cn e to the power mnx. Getting the point? So now you would have got an idea that if four of them are equal, what to do? Then there would be a cubic equation coming over here. c1x cube, c2x square, c3x plus c4 e to the power m1x, then c5 e to the power m5x, and so on and so forth. Okay, so you can continue from here. Right. Now, case number three. Okay. So, complementary functions will be required when you are dealing with those kind of circuits where there is no external EMF applied, or those kind of simple harmonic motions, or those kind of spring oscillations where there is no periodic, there is no external force applied to the system. Okay. Yeah, third case is if one of the pair of roots is imaginary. Now remember, we are dealing with k1, k2 as real numbers. So remember, if imaginary roots will exist, they will exist in conjugate pairs. So let us say, while you were evaluating the root, there were two roots which were conjugates of each other. Alpha plus I beta and alpha minus I beta, and the rest roots were like M3, M4. Normal, your real roots. Okay, so these are all your real roots. In such cases, what happens? Your complementary function will become, e to the power alpha x c1 cos beta x. Remember, alpha was the real part of M1 and beta was the imaginary part of M1. Okay, plus C2 sine beta x, and the normal process will work for M3, M4, that is C3, M3, e to the power M3x, C4, e to the power M4x, and so on till your Cn e to the power MnX. Okay, this is the one which is basically used in the simple harmonic motion. Let's say unforced simple harmonic motion. Remember, your simple harmonic motion used to get your x as a function of t, which was having cos and sine term. Okay, so this falls into that category. Now, a natural question will arise in the mind of the students. What if two of the imaginary roots are equal? Okay, so what if there is a repeated or imaginary root? So let us say we have a case where M1 and M2 is your alpha plus I beta, and let's say M3 and M4 are alpha minus I beta, and rest roots are your normal ones. So let's say M5, M6, etc. till Mn are your real roots coming out from the roots of the auxiliary equation. So in such cases, again, there will be a minor change in the complementary function. It will become e to the power alpha x. Now see what will happen. A small change. Instead of the c1, you will write c1x plus c2 cos beta x. And instead of the c2, you would write c3x plus c4 sine beta x. And other roots will continue in general like they used to continue in the previous cases. So you will have C5 e to the power M5x, C6 e to the power M6x, all the way till Cn e to the power Mnx. Okay, so you will not get more than these cases, my dear, to find out the complementary function. Now let us look into few examples. I think examples are the best way to understand these concepts. Let us say I want to find out the complementary function for this differential equation. Okay. Now, thankfully, I would take a very simple example here. Okay. So I will take a very simple example here. Let's find out the complementary function for this. Okay, and let us say I give you some initial conditions that x0 is 0, and let's say the derivative of the function, let me write it like this, derivative of the function at x equal to 0 is 15. Okay, now these are your initial conditions. Since this is a second order differential equation with the dependent variable as x and independent variable as t, I need two initial conditions or two boundary conditions to get my arbitrary constant. Okay, so let us find out the CF in this case. Okay, now for CF, we first need to make the auxiliary equation. Okay, for auxiliary equation, we get d squared plus 5d plus 6 equal to 0. Okay, this is factorizable. Okay, I get two roots from here, which are minus 2 and minus 3. Okay, So your complementary function will become, your complementary function will become, in this case, c1 e to the power minus 2t. Remember, now your independent variable is t, and c2 e to the power minus 3t. Okay. Now, luckily in this case, your complementary function will be your complete solution because there is a zero on the right side. See, try to understand, my dear students here, that particular integral will come into play when there is a function over here. Okay, when there is a function of x over here or some other constants over here. Right now, since there is a zero over here, there will be no particular integral. So your complete solution would be same as your complementary function. Okay, role of particular integral will come when there is a function of x on the right side of this equal to sign. Now, how do I find c1 and c2? Because if I get that, I will get my complementary function, and hence I will get my complete solution. So let us use these boundary conditions. x0 is 0 means when t is 0, the value of x is 0. So now remember, x will become your c1 e to the power minus 2t, c2 e to the power minus 3t. So put t equal to 0 and put x equal to 0, you will get c1 plus c2. That's number one case, number one equations. And the derivative of it, dx by dt, if you do, you will end up getting minus 2 c1 e to the power minus 2t minus 3 c2 e to the power minus 3t. Put value of dx by dt as 15 and x and t value as 0, you will get minus 2 c1 minus 3 c2. Solve these two simultaneously to get c1 and c2. Your c1 value, without much waste of time, will come out to be 15, and c2 will come out to be minus 15. So in this case, your complete solution will become 15 e to the power minus 2t minus 15 e to the power minus 3t. So this would be your complete solution for this differential equation. Again, there is no particular integral here because there was a presence of zero. I will come to particular integrals when I take such a scenario. Let us take one more example. Let us say we want to solve this differential equation. Again, I'm keeping zero on the right side because I don't want to involve particular integral right now. We'll talk about it little later on in today's session. So if you see the auxiliary equation here, auxiliary equation will be d square plus 6d plus 9 equal to 0. Here you realize that your auxiliary equation will give you repeated roots. Okay, so the roots here are minus 3 minus 3, isn't it? It's a repeated root. So in such cases, your complementary function and hence your complete solution will become c1 plus c2x. Now remember, there is no x, there is a t here. So c1 plus c2t e to the power of minus 3t it will become. Okay, so this will also become your complete solution. Okay, since I have not given you any boundary conditions to find c1, c2, we will leave the answer in this form only. Okay, let me take one more quick example for you. Let's say I want to solve d3y by dx cube plus d2y by dx square plus 4dy by dx plus 4y equal to 0. Okay, again, I have purposely taken a 0 on this case so that we don't get any particular solution. So if you write down the auxiliary equation here, what will it be? D cube plus d square plus 4d plus 4. Okay, put it equal to 0. It is not, see, you're not putting it 0 because there is 0 over here. Auxiliary equation always is formed by writing the operator d equation equated to 0. Okay. So this will give you, if you factorize this, this will give you d square plus 4 times d plus 1. So what is happening here? You get one root as minus 1, and you'll get two imaginary roots from here. Okay. So the other roots are 2i and minus 2i. Correct? Yeah. So, in this case, your complementary function, also the complete solution in this case, will become c1 e to the power minus x. Okay. And remember, the real part of these two conjugates are zero. So you'll have e to the power 0x, which you don't need to write actually. C1 cos 2x, C2 sin 2x. I have written it here so that your understanding is clear. So ultimately, your complete solution will be y equal to C1 e to the power minus x. Okay. Oh, sorry, I should not use the same name of the arbitrary constants here. There will be three arbitrary constants because it's a third order differential equation. So the complementary function would be this. Okay. I hope this example was a good enough example for you to understand things. All right, students, let's talk about particular integrals. So far, we were talking only about finding complementary function. Now we'll talk about particular integral. So particular integral will make sense when you have, instead of zero, an x over here, right? So let us say this is your original linear differential equation given to you with a function of x over here. Okay. Once you have a function of x over here, then only particular integral makes sense. Remember, if there is a zero over here, then your complete solution can only be found out by using complementary function. So what I want to say is, if your x is 0, then your complete solution will be just your CF. But if your x is some function of x, let's say I call it as g of x, then of course your complete solution will have a complementary function plus particular integral. Okay. So how do we find out this particular integral? Let's talk about it. So first of all, the process is very similar. The beginning part of the process is similar to what we use in complementary function. First, we need to frame up the left-hand side of the auxiliary equation, which is actually dn, k1 d to the power n minus 1, k2 d to the power n minus 2, and so on, till let's say kn. Okay, so what I'll do is, I'll call this guy as f of d. Okay, now in order to find out the particular integral, please note, you have to do the inverse of this operator on the function x given to you. Okay. So this function x will be given to you in the question. You have to do this operation. Now, how do I do this operation and what is 1 by f of d? Okay. So don't worry about it. I'll explain you in simple terms. Let me write down this as, let's say, f of d is a polynomial in d which is factorizable. Let's say these are the roots of f of d equal to 0. Okay. So let's say I factorize it like this. So f of d is factorizable like this. So first, what do we do is, we treat this as if we have a case of a partial fraction scenario like this. Okay, we all have done partial fractions, right? In class 11th, you would have done partial fractions. While doing indefinite integrals, you would have done partial fractions. So let's say you break this up into partial fractions like a1 d minus m1, a2 d minus m2, and so on till let's say an d minus mn. Okay, find out your a1, a2 till an by your smart substitution method or comparison of coefficient of various powers of d. There are so many ways to find out the a1, a2, a3, etc. Once you have found out, let me give you a small formula by which you can compute this. Okay. The formula is here 1 by d minus a of any function is given by e to the power ax integral of x e to the power minus ax dx. Okay, so this is all you need to know. Okay, and you will be able to manage all questions related to particular integrals. So please make a note of this. Now, how is this going to help us in solving particular integrals? See, now that you have broken 1 by fd in partial fractions, so what are you trying to calculate? You are trying to calculate 1 by or inverse of fd on x function. Okay, whatever is your x function. That means you are trying to do this a by d minus m1 plus a2 by d minus m2 and so on till a n by d minus m n on the x function. Okay, so you can break this up as a1 d minus m1 on x plus a2 d minus m2 on x and so on till a n d minus m n on x. Okay, so this is nothing but a1. Okay, now treat as if you're doing 1 by d minus m1 on x. Okay, so how will you do this? Very simple. We have already discussed the formula over here. 1 by d minus a on the function x, or you can say inverse of d minus a operator on function x, will lead into this integral e to the power ax integral x e to the power minus ax dx. So in a similar way, this fellow, it will result into e to the power m1x integral of x times e to the power minus m1x dx. Okay, and same will be true for the others also. Correct. So you will have, next one is a2 e to the power m2x integral x e to the power minus m2x. Okay, and so on. Okay, so the next term would be a3 e to the power m3x integral capital X, whatever is that function given to you, that depends upon the function. So I'm just writing as capital X as of now, but you will act as per the question given to you. Okay, so finally, the last term also, let me conclude here since I've started writing this. Okay, this would be e to the power mnx integral of capital X e to the power minus mnx dx. Okay, fine. Now, many times this computation will take a lot of your time. So there are certain standard cases that we have already formulated. So there are 3-4 cases, and those 3-4 cases are always asked in the exam. So what we have done, we have simplified this act for you through cases. Okay, so I will run you through certain cases by which you can find out particular integral very quickly. Okay, so I'll take case number one. First, I will start with that case where your function given to you is an exponential function like this. Okay, in such cases, your particular integral that you're trying to evaluate, that means 1 by fd. Remember, fd was the left-hand side of the auxiliary equation. Okay, this term will just become e to the power ax by fa. But this is provided your f of a is non-zero. Okay, so what you have to do is, you just have to put this a, okay, in the left hand side of the auxiliary equation that you had got. So remember, you made an auxiliary equation. So left hand side of the auxiliary equation, that is what we call as fd, the polynomial in d, right? There you need to put, instead of d, this value of a, but this is to be used only when fa is not zero. Okay, for example, let us say I have given you this particular differential equation, d2y by dx square plus 5dy by dx plus 6y is equal to e to the power x. Okay, now let us do a complete question on this. Let's say I ask you to find out the complete solution for this. So complete solution will have complementary function plus a particular integral. Correct? Now particular integral will feature in over here because there is no more zero on the right side. As you can see, they have given you a x for that, capital X. That is the function of x. Okay. So complementary function, you already know that you have to form an auxiliary equation. Look at this and tell me what is the auxiliary equation that you will get for this. You'll get d square plus 5d plus 6 equal to 0. Correct? And its roots are, we can all know its roots is minus 2 and minus 3. So complementary function would be c1 e to the power minus 2x, c2 e to the power minus 3x. So no problem with complementary function. Now particular integral will be 1 by fd, which is this term. Remember, I'm calling this as fd. This whole term here is fd term. Okay, this is your fd term. Okay, so you're trying to evaluate something like this. Now, as this particular method says, you just need to put this a in place of d over here. So I'm going to put 1 in place of this, so it will become e to the power x by 1 square plus 5 into 1 plus 6, which is actually e to the power x by 12. So what will be my complete solution? My complete solution would be c1 e to the power minus 2x, c2 e to the power minus 3x plus ex by 12. Now many people ask me, sir, there is no arbitrary constant in particular integral. No, there is no arbitrary constant in particular integral. Please make a note of this. A particular integral will not have or does not contain any arbitrary constant. Does not contain any arbitrary constant. Please make a note of this. Very important. Okay. So I hope with this example, it is clear that how do we deal with particular integral when your capital X function is an exponential function like this. Okay, so now people say, what if, sir, FA was 0? Then how would your formula change? So if FA is 0, if FA becomes 0, please note, there will be a small change in the particular integral. It would become X into e to the power AX by F dash A. Okay, but this is again provided F dash A is not equal to 0. Okay, again. What if f dash a is 0, then what to do then? If f dash a is 0, then again, not to worry. Your particular integral, let me write it in different color. Your particular integral will become x square e to the power ax by f double dash a. Okay. And it can go on and on like this. So on. Okay. So don't worry. Even if your f a was becoming 0 or f dash a was becoming 0 or f double dash a was becoming 0. This is the trend which we need to follow. Now, I would not go into the proofs for this because this is a short video I would like all of you to just see in order to deal with your physics problems. Now, case number two, I will talk about where your right hand side function is either a sine function, you can say sine ax plus b type of a function, or it's a cos function, cos ax plus b type of a function. Now here, please pay attention. It is slightly tricky. We need to follow this formula. F of d square, that means inverse of f d square, sine ax plus b is basically sine ax plus b upon f of negative a square. Okay, but this is when your negative f of negative a square is not 0, provided f of negative a square is not 0. Okay, similarly, 1 by f d square cos ax plus b is given by cos ax plus b upon f of negative a square. Again, the same condition, provided f of negative a square is not 0. Now, many people fail to understand this. What is the meaning of f d square? Up till now, it was f d. How all of a sudden you started talking about f d square and all those things. Okay, let me explain this with a simple example. Let us say, I want to solve this differential equation, d2y by dx square let me take slightly more complicated version, d3y by dx cube, so that you people will understand. You'll think that sir took d square because he had a d square in the question. Okay, so let me take d3y by dx cube plus y is equal to, let's say, cos of 2x minus 1. I want to solve this differential equation. Okay, so as you know, complete solution will have two parts, complementary function and particular integral. Okay, for complementary function, what do we do? Let's quickly revise what we had learned. We form an auxiliary equation like this. Okay, so what would be the roots of this auxiliary equation? Minus 1 would be one of the roots. Okay, so let me write down the roots for this. Your roots would be minus 1, minus omega and minus omega square. I hope you all know the complex number minus omega and minus omega square. So minus omega is negative of minus half plus I root 3 by 2. And minus omega square is negative of minus half minus I root 3 by 2. Okay. In short, your roots will be half minus I root 3 by 2 and half plus I root 3 by 2. Okay. Now, remember, for this, your complementary function will be c1 e to the power minus x. But what happens in case of complex roots? You will have e to the power ax, which is going to be e to the power half x. C1 cos beta x plus c2 sine beta x. Okay. Remember, we had seen this. So this is going to be your complementary function. Now remember, this is c2, this is c3. Okay, that was a slip of pen. This is c2 and this is c3. Okay, so three arbitrary constants will come. Now arbitrary constants, they will only come in case of complementary function. Arbitrary constants will never come in case of a particular integral. Please keep that in your mind. Very, very important. Okay, now let us move on to particular integral. So how to find particular integral for this? So let me just name a subtopic, particular integral. So 1 by f d square. Now see, you have to treat this as a function of d square. All of you see how it works. So what I will do, this d cube, I will break it up as a d square into d plus 1. Okay. So in place of d square, you have to put a minus a square. See here, the formula. This is the formula which we are going to follow here. In place of d square, you are going to put a minus a square. Remember, a here is 2. So minus a square here would be minus 4. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to write this like this. So 1 by d square d plus 1 cos of 2x minus 1. So this will become 1 by minus 4 d plus 1 of cos 2x minus 1. Okay. Now what to do next? Simple. I will do 1 plus 4d multiplication both in the numerator and denominator. So it was 1 minus 4d. So I multiplied and divide with 1 plus 4d. Okay. Oh, can we do that? Yes, very much we can do that. So in the numerator, it will remain 1 plus 4d of cos 2x minus 1. Remember, d is an operator. Don't treat it like it's a multiplication of two terms. Denominator, you will have 1 minus 16d square. Now again, this d square you have to put as a minus 4. Okay, so wherever a d square is coming, immediately you have to put it as a minus 4. So it will become 1 plus 4d by 65. Okay, now this operator will work on cos 2x minus 1. Now see what is happening on the numerator part. All of you please pay attention. 1 into this will remain the same function. But when d is operating on it, it will differentiate it. Remember, d is a differentiation operator. Okay. So the answer that you would get is 1 by 65 cos 2x minus 1. So basically when 1 multiplies to this, nothing will happen. But 4d, what if it will do? It will differentiate it. So it will give you something like, let me put 1 by 65 outside. So 4 times derivative of this will be minus 8 sine 2x. Minus 8 sine 2x. And remember, derivative 4 times the derivative of the whole thing. Derivative here will follow chain rule. So minus sine 2x into 2. So 8 factor will come over here. So this whole thing will actually become your particular integral. Are you getting my point? So this is your complementary function. This becomes your particular integral. Okay. So your complete solution would be, let me just copy first. What is your particular complementary function? C1 e to the power minus x plus e to the power half x. Then C2 cos of root 3 by 2x plus C3 sine of root 3 by 2x plus 1 by 65. Now I've started writing the particular integral. 1 by 65 cos 2x minus 1 minus 8 times sine 2x minus 1. Okay, this is your complete solution. C1, C2, C3 would be arbitrary constant that you need to find out from your boundary conditions. Now, what will happen if your f of minus a square happened to be 0? When such things will happen, remember, the formula will change like this. So 1 by fd square sine or cos, whatever you may take, it will become x times 1 by f dash minus a square sine ax plus b. Now, what is the meaning of f dash a square? Now, whatever was your left hand side of the auxiliary equation, you differentiate it once. Correct. You differentiate it once and then put the value of d square as minus a square as I discussed with you in the previous problem. Okay. Let me take a small example of the same. Let us say I want to find out the particular integral. I want to find out the particular integral for this function. Only the particular integral. I'll not do the complementary function part because of the time issues. Okay, let's say I have this question. And my question is, find the particular integral for this. Okay, so first of all, if you see your auxiliary equation, left hand side would be dq plus 4d, right? Is it? It's basically d times d square plus 4. Okay. So now when I do the particular integral formula, it is 1 by d square plus 4 into sine of 2x. Correct? Okay. Now what will happen here if I put, remember my a is 2 here. So if I put my d square as minus 2 square, that means 4 minus 4 will cancel off. Correct? So I cannot put here. So what I will do, the formula suggests that you need to differentiate this guy. So what is the derivative of d cube plus 4d with respect to d? So you have to do this. So that will give you 3d square plus 4, right? So now your formula will change to x by 1 by 3d square plus 4 sine 2x. Now you can put your d square as a minus 4. So when you do that, you end up getting 3 into minus 4 plus 4 sine 2x. In other words, your particular integral will become x by 8 minus x by 8 sine 2x. Okay. Again, this is subject to the fact. This is subject to the fact. I forgotten to write over here. This is subject to the fact provided your f dash of minus a square is not 0. Okay. So a genuine question will arise in your mind. What if f dash minus a square was 0? So if that is the case, then you can continue the process further. That means your particular integral. So I'll write it down over here. So if your f dash of negative a square was 0, then your particular integral will become x square 1 by f double dash of minus a square sine of ax plus b. And this will continue on and on and on till you are getting f dash or f nth derivative of a square as 0. So this is also provided f double dash of negative a square is non-zero. Is this fine? Okay. Now we'll come to the third case. Okay. Third case is where your right hand side function is a polynomial in x. Let's say I take for general purpose x to the power m. Okay. In such cases, what do? We use the binomial expansion of the given term. How do we do that? I'll explain this through an example. Okay. This is best understood with an example. Let us say I want to get the particular integral for this ordinary linear differential equation. D2y by dx square plus dy by dx is equal to x square plus 2x plus 4. Let's say I want to solve this. Okay, so in this case, what is your left hand side of the auxiliary equation? D square plus d, right? Okay. Now you want to find out the particular integral. So particular integral will be what? Particular integral will be 1 by this of your x, capital X. This is your capital X term. Okay. So x square plus 2x plus 4, you are applying the inverse of d square plus d. See, now what you do with this d square by d, you write it like this. Okay. Fine. Now let 1 by d be as it is. D plus 1 to the power minus 1. Okay. Write the binomial expansion for this. Okay. So it is like I'm asking you to write what is the binomial expansion for 1 plus d inverse. So you can treat it as 1 plus d inverse if you want for your convenience. Basically, it will be a geometric progression with infinitely big geometric progression with first term as 1, common ratio as minus d, isn't it? So it will be 1 minus d plus d square minus d cube plus d4 ... up to infinity. Okay. But don't worry, you will not require to that extent. See, when you do d, you are doing differentiation. Okay. When somebody says d of x, means you are doing d by dx of that term. When somebody says 1 by d of x, you're doing the integration of that term. Okay, please remember this fact. Please remember this simple thing. It's very, very important. So what you're doing here, you are, let's say I keep this operator as of now. Okay. 1 into this will give you x square plus 2x plus 4. Minus d on this will give you the derivative of that. So 2x plus 2 will come. D square of this will further give you the derivative of this, which will be 2. After that, even if you do one more derivative, it will become 0. So there's no point going further. Correct. Now, the process is not completed. I'll just simplify this. So this is going to give you an x square plus 4. Correct. 1 by d means integration of this. So it will be x cube by 3 plus 4x. Now, many people ask me, sir, after doing integration, can I put a constant of integration? No. Please don't do that. I have already told you, in particular integral, no arbitrary constant will appear. So this will become your particular integral in this case. Got the point? Okay. So these are the three main cases that you will be getting for finding a particular integral. Okay. So I would like to seal this up with a small question. Alright, so let's say we have this differential equation and I want to find out the complete solution for this. Complete solution means I want complementary function plus particular integral. Okay, now of course, since you have something on the right side of this linear differential equation, there would be some particular integral coming. And purposely, I have taken a mix of exponential, trigonometric and polynomial function in this case so that you can, you know, revise all the concepts. So first of all, I will go for auxiliary equation here. Auxiliary equation would be d square minus 4d plus 4. Okay, put it 0 because that is required for us to find the complementary function. So the roots that come out from here is repeated roots from here because this is actually d minus 2 the whole square. Am I right? Okay, so two repeated roots will come out from here, 2, 2. So complementary function, we can write straight away from here. It will be c1 plus c2x e to the power 2x. Remember, when roots are repeated, this is what we follow. Okay. Now, what about particular integral? Particular integral will take them one by one. Okay, so we'll break it up as 8 e to the power 2x, 8 sine 2x and 8 x square. So let us first cater to 1 by fd. Fd will be d minus 2 whole square e to the power 8 e to the power 2x. So 8 will be outside e to the power 2x. Now the problem is when you put a 2 here, it will become a 0. Remember, when fd, when fa becomes 0, we have to differentiate once and put an x. But the problem is even when you differentiate it once more and put d as 2, it will still become a 0. So what we'll do is we'll do 8 x square e to the power 2x, the double derivative of this term. Double derivative of this will leave you with a 2. Correct? So this answer will straight away become 8 by 2, which is 4 x square e to the power 2x. Okay, so let me call it as particular integral 1. Particular integral 2. Now, why I'm calling it as particular integral 1, 2, 3? Because there are three functions there. So I'll add them all after I'm done with all the three of them. So next is 1 by d minus 2 the whole square of 8 sine 2x. Right? So the other function that I have is 8 sine 2x. Okay. Actually, 8 is just a constant that will have no role to play. But here also you realize that it will become 1 by d square minus 4d plus 4 sine 2x. Put your d square as minus a square. So this will become 8, 1 by minus 4 minus 4d plus 4 sine 2x. Okay, 4 and 4 will get cancelled off. So this will give you minus 2, 1 by d of sine 2x. Now remember, my dear students, what did I tell you a little while ago? 1 by d means you are doing the integration of this. Okay, 1 by d means you are doing the integration of this. Are you getting my point? Okay, so when you do the integration of this, you will get negative cos 2x by 2. Correct? So this will just leave you with a cos 2x. So this is your particular integral obtained from this trigonometric term. Right? Now we'll have to go to the last term, which is 8x square. So I'll do that also. So 1 by fd, that is xd minus 2 whole square of 8x square. So 8 I'll keep outside, x square. Okay. As I told you, you can use binomial over here. So what I'll do first, I will take out, I will write it as d times, okay, 1 by, or you can write it like this, 8 into 1 by d by 2 the whole square. Correct? Okay. So this will give you 2, and if you take it in the numerator, it will become 1 minus d by 2 to the power minus 2 of x square. Okay. Let us apply binomial expansion on this. So this will become 2 times 1 plus d. Remember, minus 2 into minus d by 2 will give you a d. Next term would be minus 2 minus 3 by 2 factorial d square by 4 and so on. I don't need to go further because if I do, it would be of no use because this is a second degree polynomial. So d cube will all give you 0, 0 results, right? So don't go too far because it will not be of any use to you. Correct? So if I just simplify this, I get 2 times 1 plus d plus 3 by 4 d square dot dot operator operated on x square. So this will give me 2 x square. So 1 into x square will give you x square. D of x square will give you 2x because it will differentiate it. D of x square means derivative of x square. Then 3 by 4 into derivative of this guy, which is 2. Okay. So if I multiply, I will get 2x square plus 4x plus 3. Correct? So this is your PI 3. Okay. So your final PI, your final PI would be the sum of all the PIs that you have got. So PI1, PI2, PI3. See, I've just named it PI1, PI2, PI3 just for your convenience. Okay, so if you don't want to name it like that, it is up to you. So your final particular integral will be 4x square e to the power 2x, then cos 2x, and then finally this 2x square plus 4x plus 3. Okay, so what's your complete solution? Complete solution is CF plus PI. Remember CF plus PI. What was your CF? Your CF was C1 plus C2x e to the power of 2x. And your PI is this fellow 4x square e to the power 2x cos 2x 2x square plus 4x plus 3. Okay. So dear all students, I hope this video session was useful for you to solve any linear differential equation with constant coefficient. It will be very helpful for you when you are solving your simple harmonic motion and you're dealing with oscillatory electrical circuits, whether with forced or non-forced functions on it. Thank you so much for watching.